on. Global warming affects all of us. The more we learn about the nuts and bolts of global warming, the better chance we have of doing something about it. On this next Inside NAU Science segment, Professor Bruce Hungate conducts research on the peaks on global warming.
I find ecology fascinating, microbiology especially really interesting, how soil microorganisms control nutrient cycles and how that affects how plants grow. And it turns out that those same soil microorganisms actually have the potential to impact climate. And that just blows me away. These little tiny cells in the soil having an effect on the global scale. I just think that's cool. The Earth's getting warmer. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change that synthesizes all this climate change research says that most of that warming we've seen is due to human activities. We want to be able to say how much more warming is going to happen. And one of the missing pieces is how will ecosystems respond to climate warming. One of the ways they can respond is by producing more of the very gases that warm the Earth. So this research is really focused on that question. We're using the elevation gradient right here in our backyard in Flagstaff. So we have five field stations along that gradient. They start at the top in the mixed conifer forest to the ponderosa, to the pinyon juniper woodland, to the high desert grassland, to the Great Basin Desert. To simulate global warming, what we're doing is we're taking a microecosystem, a piece of the ecosystem, the soil, the plants, all together, from one life zone, and we're moving them down the gradient one step. And what that does is it simulates roughly the warming projected for the next 50 to 100 years. It's a really nice way to manipulate warming for a couple of reasons. You're warming both the air and the soil, that's realistic, and it's very easy to maintain. We're getting ready now to measure the production and consumption of carbon dioxide, methane, and nitrous oxide from these plots.
This is the chamber that we use. It's got a attachment on the top here for the canisters. And so we place it over the core. So now we got an airtight seal. And we take one of the canisters. And that immediately sucks up a 100 cc sample. And then we use the syringe to pull an extra 60 cc's. Injected into the canister to overpressurize the canister so that we can run it on the GC back at the lab. And that would be a time zero.
Carbon dioxide is the most important greenhouse gas that humans are producing, causing to increase in the atmosphere. But methane and nitrous oxide are the next two important ones.
We're going to take a sample of the trace gas that is inside this cylinder, and we're going to inject it into our pre-concentration unit to prepare it for the gas chromatograph, which is also referred to as a GC. The gas chromatograph actually separates the different gases that are contained inside of the sample, and then it allows for a measurement to be made on a single gas. And in particular, using this instrument, we're looking at nitrous oxide.
Nitrous oxide is also laughing gas, right? What you get in the dentist's office. And it's increasing in the atmosphere. Not enough to make the world a happier place, but it is enough to contribute to the warming. Nitrous oxide, molecule per molecule, is about 300 times more effective at trapping heat than carbon dioxide. So it's an important greenhouse gas too. One of the things we hope is that by doing experiments like this, by looking into the details of one community and one ecosystem, we can take those responses and distill from them some general principles that tell us about how ecosystems will respond to climate change. The plants we see in these tiny little plots right here are actually very relevant to what we expect to see in terms of how the world works 50 to 100 years from now, when our climate presumably will be warmer.
Hi, I'm Ellen Graberick, the project director for Dale E. Webb Dental Outreach Program. You're watching Inside NAU.